today's program made possible by patrons like you. Welcome to where we celebrate music from the movies. From the golden age to present day, we've got it all covered. We talk to those in the entertainment industry and find out about their favorite scores. You found the podcast, What's the Score? I'm your host, Frank R. Wilson. So sit back, relax, grab a popcorn, and let's see what we'll be hearing today. Recognize that music? It's a favorite of our guest today. Now, he's an author, a teacher, editor, and producer. He's also a working musician in New York City, where he is an inductee of the New York Blues Hall of Fame. Finally, like me, he's a podcaster with his show Scored to Death, which focuses on scores from horror films. And yet today, his choices of favorite cues may surprise you. We'll find out more about that. But first, please join me in welcoming J. Blake Fichera to the program. Hi, Blake.
Hi, thanks for having me.
Oh, no, my pleasure. My pleasure. And I know you're part of one of our previous guests' network, Eric Woods, and you reached out and said, hey, you know, I'd love to be on your program. And when I looked at what you did, I said, yeah, absolutely. So I'm delighted to have you with us, and I appreciate you joining us.
I appreciate it. Always happy to talk.
Okay, well, so am I, as you'll probably find out. As I always start out our interviews, I always like to learn a little bit more about the individual we're talking to outside of the music world or scores or what we're going to talk about today. I want to find out the personal side about you. So if you could maybe tell us a little bit about yourself, family growing up, you know, where you grew up and, you know, kind of background like that up until your formative years, I guess.
Well, I grew up my youth, I grew up in Philadelphia until I was about 9 or 10. And then my mom got remarried and I moved to the Albany, New York area.
Wow. Okay.
And, you know, I always just had a love of movies and music and the combination of the two. So, you know, growing up in the house, we always had soundtracks, Star Wars, Jaws, a lot of John Williams. I think a lot of people of my generation, film music lovers of my generation, a lot of their loves of film music started with John Williams.
and I would agree with that. In fact, to me, in my mind, he's kind of the guy that made listening to soundtracks cool again. If that makes sense, what I'm saying? I
mean, yeah. And, you know, so in my growing up, just film music there wasn't a distinction between film music and other kinds of music. We just listened to all kinds of music. So I was very fortunate in that way, from classical to jazz, pop, rock. So I always had just kind of eclectic musical tastes, and I always loved going to the movies. My dad, when I lived in Philadelphia, would pick me up sometimes even on a weeknight after school and take me to the movies. So that love just never died. And when I was in high school, I just started loving movies. I was also grew up right at the perfect time for that kind of 90s independent film wave of Tarantino and Robert Rodriguez and Kevin Smith and all those people to really take hold. Cause those were probably my most formative years.
I'm curious. Is this when you, because I talked about in introducing you that you're a musician. Is it at the same time? Are you learning music and learning an instrument to play at the same time?
Yeah, I started. I mean, some would say late, some would say early. I started playing guitar in my teens.
Okay,
I fell in love with blues music, and also with the band Black Sabbath. And that's so right. A great combination of things, which is why, why a track like, which was a very formative track for me, and we might be talking about it later, was the main theme for In the Mouth of Madness, which was written by John Carpenter. I saw that movie at a sleepover on my birthday, like the year it came out on VHS. And by that point, my friends and I were making short films on a VHS camera.
Oh, wow.
All the time. We made them every weekend. It was our thing. And so this was kind of my mid to late teens. We were just churning out these movies. And then I rented that movie and me and my friends watched it. And that night we made our first horror movie. And that main theme just kind of captured my imagination. And the combination of rock guitar with horror music was very much in the same neighborhood as Black Sabbath in some ways, which I was getting into at the time, and heavy metal. And that was the first horror movie soundtrack that I ever purchased with my own money. You know,
I want to explore that a little bit later, if we may. It's interesting that you ever consider yourself lucky that you grew up at a time where you could do something like that so easily. I mean, make movies on the weekend. I mean, you know, unless you had a 16mm camera and sound equipment, which was a huge expense. Before VHS, you couldn't do that, but now it's pretty simple. I mean,
yeah. Well, now it's even more simple.
Well, yeah.
You know, because now people can edit and do all these things. We were editing in the camera. We were just cutting it and then changing angles and then changing back. But yeah, I grew up in the absolute perfect time to make me. You know, my generation was the first generation who grew up with the ability to watch movies at home anytime wanted.
Yeah, yeah.
The video, I call my generation the video store generation.
You know? Yeah. Oh, yeah. I used to manage a video store actually early in my professional career. So I know what you're talking about.
So, yeah, we had access to movies like the generations before us never did. So I grew up, spoiled in that way. We could rent movies. We did rent movies. Cable TV, another thing. I didn't have it at my mom's house. Not even till I got to college in the late 90s. But my dad had those things. And so when I would visit my father on weekends and when we moved to Albany, then on the holidays and stuff, I was exposed to cable TV and movies and stuff. And so it was kind of the perfect storm of events. And then the ability to make movies on VHS camera, having albums and CDs. And then all that love for things caused me to I went to film school.
Oh, okay.
I went to SUNY Purchase, which was at the time probably one of the strongest and most reputable undergraduate film programs.
Okay.
And there we shot 16mm and we edited on flatbeds.
Wow.
But it's also a half hour north of New York City. So this was another kind of perfect storm in terms of I was getting into horror movies in my high school years. My friends and I started renting horror movies every Friday, and I started to fall in love with the movies of John Carpenter. And then when I went to film school, the greatest aspect for me of going to film school was meeting other people that were as enthusiastic about films as I was. Mm-hmm. And through them, even more so than class, being introduced to films that I had never seen before. So being introduced to other horror films, and also being in film school, horror, I look back at now as being a little bit of a maybe a rebellious thing because we were learning about all the classics.
And if you don't mind, Blake, I do want to focus on that, but I want to follow up with this just a little bit later. But it's interesting how you are gravitating towards horror films, and I want to talk about that a little bit later. Your list of favorites actually fascinated me. Because they're not all horror scores. The first one of which is the film Rocky. And I love the one that you chose for that. And I'm trying to remember, what's the name of the cue? Do you recall?
Going the Distance.
Ah, yes. And I think I know what that is. But tell us a little bit about why you wanted to include that amongst your favorites.
Well, growing up a kid of Philadelphia and then moving away from Philadelphia, the Rocky movies always felt to me a little bit like a security blanket. So when I moved, you know, I missed home for a while, and the Rocky movies played on TV, even non-cable TV, all the time back then. And I knew them so well from watching them on weekends on the local Fox affiliates and whatnot that I knew exactly when the commercial breaks were coming. And even today, when I watch them, I can pinpoint in Rocky III when the next when the commercial's coming. So I grew up just loving the Rocky movies. But at some point, it's interesting because at some point the first Rocky movie stopped getting shown a lot. So really, you were just seeing sometimes two, but three and four. And the fourth score, which is not by Bill Conti, is also a score that I've come to love a lot. But when I was in my late 20s or early 30s, I was down on my luck. I was out of work. I had moved into Manhattan. I couldn't afford my apartment. I was having issues in a relationship, and we were on a break. And I was just like really down on my luck. And I was watching television, and on Turner Classic Movies, they were introducing the first Rocky movie.
Oh, yeah.
And I was like, you know what? I haven't seen the first one probably since I was 17 at that point, you know, because I just was watching all the other ones and I hadn't seen the first one in forever. And I was like, I'm going to watch it. So I sat and watched it, and it was quite literally a life-changing experience.
Oh, how neat.
The difference between watching Rocky when you're 17 and you have your whole life ahead of you and you have dreams and you think you're going to fulfill them.
Yeah.
And when you're watching the movie when you're Rocky's age and you haven't lived up to the potential you thought you were going to live up to and you're down on your luck and you are Rocky is, you know, it's mind-blowing, the difference. And so it's become a movie since then that I watch all the time, at least once a year, probably more. And I find things in it every time. It's become my favorite movie of all time. And I consider it lightning in a bottle. And part of that is that everything about that movie works, and it couldn't work better. And Bill Conti's score is one of those things. And the reason why I chose this score and this cue is because this is one of the few pieces of film music that can literally make me cry, even if I'm not watching the movie.
Wow. Listen, now you've built it up so much, we got to hear this. So let's have a listen to this. This is from the film Rocky, 1976. It's called Going the Distance, and it's written by composer Bill Conti. We'll be right back. You know, hearing that reminds me that I was very fortunate. I live in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Most of my listeners know that, which is the home of LSU, which happens to be the school that Bill Conti graduated from.
That's true.
And he gave a concert here a couple of years ago. And you know what? The guy was extremely entertaining. He was so hilarious. And of course, his music was fantastic. And I remember him joking about the fact that the Rocky movie basically paid for his kids' college education. You know, and he made a big deal out of that. So that was just a little side note I thought I'd share and pass along. If he's ever doing a, I don't know if he'll do concerts again, but if he does, you buy a ticket because I promise you, you'll be entertained. Not only because of the music, but because of him.
Yeah. He's amazing. I had the opportunity to interview him quite in quite detail, just as we were getting the pandemic, maybe even beforehand.
Wow.
And it was one of the thrills. I've been fortunate to interview many composers. It's a passion of mine. But since Bill Conti is such a big hero of mine, that was really special.
Yeah. Maybe we'll talk off air or something. I've been trying to pursue that as well, but to no avail. But anyway, you mentioned several times already this affinity that you have for horror movies. And I guess in addition to that, scores from horror movies. What was it that had you gravitate to that genre?
Yeah, so when I was in film school, I started to get into horror movies. And I kind of already was. You know, my friends and I were renting movies, and I was already into the music of John Carpenter. But when I was in film school, I started to watch Italian horror movies. And I got introduced to the films of Dario Argento and Lucio Fulci. And through those movies, the music of the band Goblin, which was a progressive rock band that did a lot of soundtracks in Italy throughout the 70s and 80s. The composer Fabio Frizzi, who composed a lot of Lucio Fulci stuff. And I just absolutely fell in love with the music. And that love just kind of never died, you know. And basically, more than anyone else, John Carpenter, the band Goblin, and Fabio Frizzi ended up being why I pursued later interviewing composers. And I started doing that for what would become a book, and then two books, and then a podcast. The books are called Scored to Death. And my reason for doing that was really just because at the time, there was not a lot of information available especially about the Italian composers, at least in English. I don't know about in Italy. And I wanted to know about them. And so I decided to just ask if I could interview them so that I could find out the information that I wanted to know. And that's kind of how it all started. And now I'm kind of known as the horror music guy because I put out these two books. And then I started to do Score to Death, the podcast, as an extension of that, where I interview, yes, a lot of horror composers, but also guys like Bill Conti who aren't horror. And I got to expand kind of my palette.
Well, I find it interesting. My listeners will know I don't have a wide variety of composers alike. I have a couple of favorites and that's it. Conti is one of them. John Barry. Everybody knows I love John Barry. I kind of like John Williams, kind of. I really like Jerry Goldsmith. But a dark horse in that is John Carpenter. I've been impressed. I mean, the guy's a director, but he's also, it's pretty amazing that the guy can direct a movie and write a script, but also do the score for it. I mean, that's amazing. Have you ever had a chance to talk with him?
I had the honor and the intimidation of of interviewing John Carpenter for my first book.
Wow.
Which is titled Score to Death, Conversations with Some of Horror's Greatest Composers.
Wow.
And in that book, I interviewed Carpenter. I interviewed Claudio Simonetti and Maurizio Guarini from the band Goblin, Fabio Frizzi. But I also interviewed the composers of the Hellraiser score, Friday the 13th, Nightmare on Elm Street. A lot of really great, amazing composers. But John Carpenter was definitely the most intimidating because, one, my love for him and his music and his movies. He's also he's not a talker. So he's a yes or no kind of guy. And sometimes you have to pull a little bit to get more out of him. But what's interesting about him as a composer, when you interview him about his music, is that unlike all the other people I've interviewed, he maybe now is different because he's become a bit of a rock star and has released albums of music. But back then when I interviewed him, he definitely did not consider himself a composer. You know, he was a filmmaker, and making music was an extension of that, and quite literally an afterthought because it was the last thing he did in the filmmaking process. Yeah. So he just didn't verbalize, you know, making music the same way that people whose real focus in their career is on that. But yeah, I did get to interview him, and it was
amazing. Cool. That's cool. Well, speaking of John Carpenter, the next cue that you had chosen as a favorite is from a film called In the Mouth of Madness. Comes from done in 1994. The score is written by John Carpenter and also Jim Lang, who I know nothing about that individual. But tell me a little bit about, because you had a wide variety of things to choose from John Carpenter, why was it you chose this one in particular as one of your favorites?
Yeah, I kind of alluded to this earlier because this piece of music is kind of monumental, and I never would have written the books or gotten into horror film music in the way that I did had I not watched In the Mouth of Madness and fallen in love with this theme when I was a teenager. And I can trace it all the way back to then. It just captured my imagination. It kind of explored horror film music, but also rock and heavy metal in a way. And when I, the month that my book, the first book came out, was released, which was, I think, July of 2016, John Carpenter went on tour for the first time.
Wow.
Playing music.
Really? I didn't know that.
and I got to see him live in New York City the week that the book came out. And right before the encore, he played this piece of music. And there's a section when we listen to it, you'll hear that kind of the band cuts out and it's keyboards. And when they did it live, the band took a step back, the spotlight hit John, and he just played this kind of ethereal ambient keyboard stuff. And at that moment, I felt, it was like a weird full circle thing. I felt a lot of pride for having put out a book because I didn't know if I could do it. And it was a lot of work. I spent years on it.
Oh yeah.
And it was at that point, probably the biggest professional accomplishment of my life. And at that moment, I traced it all the way back to this song. And I was overwhelmed with emotion when I saw it live, and I started to cry.
Don't be ashamed of that. I've been there too. I know what you mean.
And it meant a lot to me, and to be able to see him play live, which I never would have imagined possible when I fell in love with his music. And then even when I first interviewed him for the book, you know, there wasn't even an album of original music from him on the horizon. And then by the time the book came out, he had an album of original music. Just everything was coming together in a weird way. And this piece of music has just meant a lot to me.
Because
of all that.
You've teed it up really nice. Let's have a listen to this. This is from the film In the Mouth of Madness, I think. Is the cue called the same thing, I think?
Yeah, it's basically the main title cue.
Okay, main title. It's from a film in 1994, and it's written by composers John Carpenter and Jim Lang. We'll be right back. You know, and looking through your list of scores and cues that you chose, I found it kind of interesting because I know your love is for horror scores and those sorts of things. And yet I don't know the films well enough, but there's only two or three out of all of them that you chose that were horror. And most surprisingly, this is not a criticism. I'm fascinated by it. Most of the ones that you chose were either from the 60s, 70s, or 80s. So I'd be curious, you kind of tell me about why, in your view, maybe are you gravitating towards the scores that were written in that time period?
I guess because they're the scores I grew up with. And though I love contemporary films and film music, I had a podcast for a while that, you know, we did pretty well, but we ended up stopping and we're technically on a break. We're not sure if we'll come back, but it was a podcast that was based mostly in nostalgia of films. And we talked a lot about the 80s and 90s because that's when my co-host and I grew up, but we both, just being film lovers, we just love movies. And so the reason why I chose not as many horror film cues is one, because my tastes are not strictly for horror. Two, I very rarely get to talk about anything but horror on podcasts.
No, and by the way, I love it. I love the fact that you've chosen a wide variety, not only in terms of genres, but also in terms of time periods. So I think it's great. I was just kind of curious to explore that.
Yeah, I love all kinds of music, and that includes all kinds of film music. And one of the beautiful things about film music is that it maybe is not so representative in most of the cues that I picked, but like film music can encompass any genre. There are jazz scores, and believe me, I was very tempted to pick something from Lalo Schifrin, more of a jazz flair, when you asked me to put together a list of things. So I just, you know, these are all scores that in some way or another, I think were important to me or are important to who I am. Some of the horror films cues we might talk about are also a little bit representative of stuff that I talk about in my second book, which is my latest book, Score to Death 2.
Okay. Well, you know, and you mentioned earlier, John Williams as being an influence. And you wanted to choose a cue from Star Wars.
I'm sure many people do.
the hologram. Let me see here. The hologram and binary sunset. Yeah. Tell me a little bit about why you decided to choose that amongst your favorites, because I'm a big fan of that as well.
The Superman score was also huge for me. So it was tough to pick, but Star Wars, in that whole section of when I was talking about, I was falling in love with movies. Star Wars was such a big part of that. They had come out on VHS at that point, and I got them for Christmas. And probably one of the main reasons I wanted to make movies as a kid was because of my love for Star Wars. This cue specifically is, one, just beautiful. Two, in a lot of ways, looking back on it as an adult and watching the movie now, kind of captures for me the soul of what the whole movie is about. You know, the scene of, you know, the call to action of seeing the hologram of Princess Leia, and then the boy who wants more, who wants adventure to get off this crazy sand planet, standing and looking at the sunset, wishing for a different future than what seems to be laid out in front of him, is for me the soul of the movie. And this piece of music is kind of represents that perfectly for me.
Yeah, perfect. And you know, I would say that this probably could very well be the start of the boom of interest in film scores again, that got younger people interested in film music. With the Star Wars, it was a two album release, right?
Double album. Yeah.
So I mean, it was amazing. So yeah, let's hear this for ourselves. This is from the original Star Wars, 1977. Of course, it's known as Episode 4 as well now. And it's the hologram Binary Sunset, and it's written by the maestro, John Williams. We'll get back to our program in a minute. This program is done for the love of film and film music, plain and simple. However, it does take a huge investment in time and in fees for me to make the program work for you. I don't sell commercial time and don't really want to on this program. Rather, I'm kind of like a public broadcasting station. I need support from listeners like you. For as little as $3 a month, you can help me offset the time spent in putting the program together. Or maybe you just think of it as leaving a tip in the tip jar. Either way, if you can join up, there will be bonuses, like an additional 10 to 15 minute segment with our guest every week. Well, we'll play additional cues as well as ask some extra questions. And it's going to be only available to patrons. How do you sign up? Well, it's simple. You go to patreon.com/whatsthescore, and that's all one word. That's Patreon, that's patreon.com/whatsthescore. Check it out. We'd be grateful for your support. That's patreon.com. As I mentioned when I introduced you, you also happen to, like me, host a podcast. It's called Scored to Death, and would like you to tell us a little bit about that. What was the genesis behind that starting in the first place? And, you know, just tell us a little bit about what you cover and what you do on that podcast.
Sure. I actually have two called Scored to Death. I have Scored to Death podcast, which is a little bit of an extension of my books, which is where I interview composers. I don't do it a whole lot because it's a lot of work. I do have one great interview in the can with David Shire, which I have yet to start to edit.
Excellent.
But the podcast that I do more often, because it's slightly easier in terms of just workload, is I do a show called Score to Death Radio on the Cinematic Sound Radio Network.
Oh, okay. The same thing that Eric Woods is in charge of, right? Part of his baby, yeah.
Eric had invited me to do something there. I used to do a show called Cuts from the Crypt for a British network called the Damn Fine Network. And it was actually the host of the Damn Fine Network. He actually posted that show. And then his workload got too much. And he asked me if I would take over. And it's basically a kind of a radio show format where I get to introduce horror film cues. And then I play the cues sometimes I like to play the music and then introduce the cues. And then when that ended, that network ended, and I was kind of looking for ways to do it. Something similar, not the exact show, but something similar that was more my own. I knew Eric through the Twitter and whatnot, and we had become friendly, and he had this network. And so I started doing Score to Death Radio for him. And so it's kind of a music show. What I say is my books and Score to Death, the podcast, kind of celebrate composers and the craft of film scoring. And with Score to Death Radio, I get to celebrate the music.
Isn't it interesting? I mean, there are people that you're friends with and that you actually really probably know pretty well that you've never met because of social media. Is it, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, absolutely.
The next cue that you chose, I'm guessing, goes back to horror. This is from the film The House on Sorority Row, and it's the main title from that. Talk to us a little bit about why you wanted to include that amongst your favorites.
Yeah, I got the chance to interview the composer Richard Band for Score to Death 2, my second book. And I had always appreciated Richard's music because he had scored some films that I really love. But it was through researching his interview that I just started to absolutely fall in love with his music and his talent. And then through interviewing him and learning about the way he works, just even more so. And the why I picked House on Sorority Row is because it, through doing all this interviewing and writing about film music, I've come to learn that obviously film music kind of plays many functions, many roles, and has many functions in the filmmaking process. And one that I think gets overlooked is, you know, a great score can add production value. And what the beautiful thing about the House on Sorority Row score is that it's 1982. It's the slasher film boom. House on Sorority Row is a good one, but a pretty typical slasher movie for the era. And where Halloween and a lot of slasher scores were going more in the direction of synthesized scores, Richard Band does this lush orchestral score, and its main theme is this beautiful waltz that you would not even know is for a horror movie when you listen to it. And it's become one of my favorite pieces of film music ever, because it's just gorgeous. And the fact that it's for this pretty typical slasher movie just kind of floors me. The rest of the score is also a beautiful orchestra, but he starts to get more into, you know, horror conventions with a lot of the other score. But right. This theme is just beautiful, so I just had to include it.
Now, and forgive me, the name is Richard Band. Is that how you pronounce it?
Band, yeah.
Band, okay. Well, let's have a listen for ourselves. This is from the film The House of Sorority Row, and it's written by composer Richard Band. You already brought up the fact that you had written a couple of books, and I'd like to talk to you about that. I found it fascinating. And my effort to talk to various film composers, and I feel very lucky. I've had a chance to talk to many, but it sounds like you have as well. Yeah, kind of tell me a little bit about some of the discussions that you've had in putting together those books, and what were some of the names? I know you may have said some before, but
yeah,
bears worth repeating. What were some of the people that you were able to talk to on your focus on horror film scores?
The first book is focuses a lot on franchises, but in terms of Christopher Young,
okay,
who scored Hellraiser, as well as, you know, a million other films, including many wonderful scores for not horror films, scores. Harry Manfredini, who did the Friday the 13th films, Charles Bernstein, who did the original Nightmare on Elm Street, as well as many great films inside and outside of horror, as well as more contemporary composers, Joseph Bishara, who does the Insidious and Conjuring movies. So the first book has 14 composers, and the second book has 16. The second book has Richard, who we talked about, Richard Band, Charlie Clauser, who did the Saw films. I also was able to interview, I think it's probably the last interview, with a composer named Bob Cobert, who scored the original Dark Shadows television series.
Oh, wow.
He was, I think, 94 when I interviewed him.
Oh, my gosh.
And he died, I don't know, the following year, just before COVID hit. It was said pneumonia. And I wonder if maybe he got COVID. It was really early on. It was like February, and then COVID really hit in March. That was just an amazing conversation, you know, walk down memory lane with this guy who's, you know, done so many great television and film scores throughout his long and illustrious career. And I also had the chance to interview some Asian composers for the book, the second book. It was a little bit of a process. It was done via email with translators and everything, but Kenji Kawai and Koji Endo, and just a wonderful group of composers. And then the extension of that was Score to Death, the podcast, which actually the second book kind of came out of my interviews, partially came out of my interviews for Score to Death, the podcast. But Score to Death, the podcast, I had a chance to interview Barry Dvorzon, who is a wonderful, interesting composer, fascinating conversation. Bill Conti, like I said, I have a David Shire interview that I have yet to edit that's coming up. So I've had a wonderful, a fantastic chance to interview composers dating back with Bob Cobert all the way to the 50s to, you know, contemporary composers.
It's interesting. And I have to apologize. I'm, you know, while I'm a film music fan, my breadth of knowledge about all kinds of film composers is actually pretty narrow.
Yeah.
So you're bringing up a lot of names that I'm not familiar with, but that's good. I mean, I like that. And I like the fact that you've been able to highlight some of their work, and that's great. What's my question? I guess, what is it that they bring to the film score genre, for lack of a better way of saying it? What is it they bring to it that maybe some more of the, for lack of a better term, mainstream composers bring to something like that? Is there something they do different?
I don't know if it's something that they do different. But you know, a lot of them, not all of them, but a lot of them are working with budgets that are a lot smaller than someone that, you know, like Hans Zimmer is going to be working with.
Yeah.
You know, I before I started interviewing composers, I because of my love for blues music, I wrote a weekly column for a blues internet magazine, and I got to start to interview people for that, some blues musicians, people that were my heroes in that field. And I just discovered that I really loved talking to creative people about their art. And when I started doing the interviews for the composers, it just brought me so much joy to talk to these people about what they do and how they do it. And especially at that time. Now there are many outlets. There's a lot of different film music podcasts and stuff. But when I started doing it, it seemed to me that just by the reaction that they weren't interviewed as in-depthly as I was doing it. And they, I think they were happy to be getting the recognition. And
that's been my experience. I know what you're saying.
Yeah. And happy to talk about what they do. And it's become something that I just love doing. And, you know, the focus of horror it started that way. But the truth is, my interviews for people that have read the book or listened to what I do, and to the people that haven't yet, I think you'll find that horror plays a very small part of what I talk to them about. Yes, we talk about how music functions within horror movies, and we talk about how they created those horror movie scores. But the interviews are mostly about them, you know, why they got into writing film music, their love for music, and then how they create film music.
Yeah.
Because that's what really interests me.
Now, I'm curious, because I've had the experience a couple of times to do this. Have you ever, to show you the impact of music, I'm curious, have you ever been able to see a rough cut of a film before the music has been inserted? Because it shows you just how important music is to making, to emphasizing the drama and making impact on the viewer. Have you ever had a chance to do that?
Well, you know, this is the stuff I did in film school and watching my friends' films in film school, but nothing to that extent. I mean, sometimes you get to see, you know, special features, deleted scenes that don't have music on them yet. You know, there's a famous story about John Carpenter when he was making Halloween, showed a cut of Halloween to a studio executive and he hadn't done the music yet. And they were like, this is too long. It's too scary. It doesn't work. And then he went and he scored it and he brought it back and didn't cut anything, but didn't tell them. And they were like, oh yeah, this is works. This is so much scarier. It moves so much faster. I love what you did with the editing, but he didn't change the editing. He just added music.
Added the music. Yeah. It's so powerful. It's, I encourage all my listeners, if you ever have an opportunity, I don't know how you get the opportunity, but if you ever have one, and I've had a couple, they're both James Bond movies. If you have an opportunity to see a rough cut without any music put into the film, it's amazing how flat it is. It's amazing how flat it is without the music. So it's something to keep in mind.
Film music does a million different things that we don't even think about.
Now, you also chose another cue, and my gosh, I love this composer, and he just unfortunately recently passed, but I'm glad you chose him because he's written so many. I mean, my gosh, he was prolific, like you wouldn't believe. I'm talking about the film Once Upon a Time in the, I think in the West, right?
Once Upon a Time.
And we're talking about the cue is called Man with the Harmonica. And it's written by let's face it, he's the maestro, Ennio Morricone. Tell us a little bit about why you wanted to choose that amongst one of your favorites.
Well, I just, I fell in love with Sergio Leone Westerns, like anybody else does. Yeah. And this one just happens to be my favorite. And this score is I love many Ennio Morricone scores, but this one just, I don't know, it just touches me in a way. This particular, well, the score itself, what's interesting is because the film itself is very much an ensemble piece. There are all these characters, and although all their storylines do converge, he's given each character their own theme. Leitmotif is the, each character has their own piece of music.
Yeah.
And what I find interesting is the character whose name is, I think, Harmonica in the movie, is played by Charles Bronson. He plays a harmonica throughout the film. And what he does, and Morricone does it also in For a Few Dollars More with the pocket watch that makes noise, that plays a song. But the harmonica in this film, it starts out as diegetic in that he plays it in the film, everybody can hear it, but then all of a sudden it becomes score and it's orchestrated. And I just love this piece of music because it's ominous. And as you know, I have a certain affinity for horror film music. And so it's a dark piece of music, and it's his theme, and the resolution of the Charles Bronson character is really the crux of this movie for me in a lot of ways. I could have easily have picked Jill's America, which is a beautiful piece of music. But this one it's got balls. And
Okay. Well, let's have a listen for ourselves. This again from the film Once Upon a Time in the West. The cue is called Man with a Harmonica, and it's written by the maestro Ennio Morricone. So, it seems to me like you have a lot of irons in the fire. So what's going on in your future? What are some things that maybe some of our listeners might enjoy hearing that you're working on at the moment and things they can look forward to in the future?
Well, I'm still doing Score to Death Radio over at the Cinematic Sound Radio Network. I don't do it on any particular schedule, but I try not to go too long without having an episode. And other than that, because my day job is working in television as an editor and a producer, I'm currently trying to turn the books Score to Death into a documentary or a series. So that's what I'm working on, trying to get that off the ground. So hopefully in the future, we'll have the next iteration, the next generation of Score to Death will be either a documentary film or a documentary series.
Did you see that? I think it was 2 or 3 years ago. There was a documentary on film music. I think it was just simply called Score. Did you happen to see that by any chance?
I've seen parts of it. That came out kind of soon after my first book came out, and then I was working on other stuff, and I had always had plans to make a documentary, and there was a part of me that was like, maybe I shouldn't watch this because I don't want to just remake this movie.
Well, I mean, they had an interesting approach to it. I would encourage you to watch it, if nothing else, just to kind of maybe give you some ideas or whatnot. It was very, very well done.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Very well done. It's interesting how the last cue that you had chose that we were going to talk about on this program, once again, we visit composer Bill Conti. And this is from the film. I love this film. I love the music in it, too. It's from the film called The Karate Kid. The cue is called Training Hard. It almost sounds a little bit like something of a Rocky vein that you chose earlier, but perhaps not. Tell us a little bit about why you wanted to choose that amongst your favorites.
You know, I grew up as a kid in the 80s, so The Karate Kid was big, but I didn't become to really fully appreciate The Karate Kid until I got older, and maybe even as an adult. And it's really become one of my favorite movies. It's actually a beautiful film that I don't think gets the credit it really deserves. And Conti's score for it is just gorgeous.
Mm.
And for me, this cue, like the Star Wars cue I chose, is just it's a very important cue for the film. This is the point in which, within the film, you know, Pat Morita gives his Oscar nominated performance in the scene where he's celebrating, you know, kind of the life and death of his wife.
Yeah.
And he's drunk, and Daniel comes and sees his mentor father figure in a bad way, and but puts him to bed, and in a way kind of becomes the father figure in that scene. And then we launch into this gorgeous training sequence, this montage, and it's where kind of, you know, there's a moment, you could say it's kind of where we go from act two into act three, and Daniel kind of steps up and he starts training on his own, and we start to believe that maybe he can do it, maybe he can win. Yeah. And Conti's music here is just so beautiful, and I listen to it all the time.
Yeah, let's have a listen for ourselves. Again, this is from the film The Karate Kid. The cue is called Training Hard, and it's written by composer Bill Conti.
Thank you.
Well, I can't thank you enough for joining us today. Now, I'm kind of curious if people are interested in following you and what you're doing and what you have out there, you know, online, as it were. How do people find you, and how can they connect with you, I guess, as it were?
Well, I'm on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook. My handle there is at Scored to Death. And the books are available on Amazon from other book retailers or from me directly at scoredtodeath.com. And like I said, there are Scored to Death conversations with some of horror's greatest composers, and mm-hmm. Scored to Death 2, more conversations with some of horror's greatest composers. And I, like I said, I do a somewhat regular show at the Cinematic Sound Radio Network called Scored to Death Radio.
All right. Excellent. I hope people take advantage of that. This gentleman obviously knows what he's talking about and has a real passion for it. So I have no doubt that the books and the podcast reflect that passion. So what else can I say? I really appreciate you joining us today. I hope you've enjoyed it as much as I've enjoyed talking with you today.
Absolutely. Like I said, I very rarely get to talk about, especially in film music, things other than horror movies.
So. Yeah, no, I appreciate that. I love your list. I think it was terrific. Well, listen, with that, there's not much else to say. I want to thank our guest, obviously, Blake, for joining us today. And all our patrons, by the way, who are supporting the program. I'm most grateful for that. We'll have a little bit of a bonus episode with Blake here in a moment for our patrons. That's exclusive to them. But I'm grateful for all of you. I really appreciate your support of the program and listening in. And I guess, gee, there's nothing more to say other than this. My name is Frank R. Wilson. My time's up. I thank you for yours. Thanks for listening to What's the Score?